from the United States Embassy in Japan. He is an assistant cultural affairs officer.
皆さん、おはようございます。ドブレイヤーウタ。 Good morning, everyone. My name is Jeff Adler, and on behalf of the United States Embassy in Tokyo, it is my great pleasure to join you here today at the Critical Issues Forum. As I hope many of you know already, today is a historic day as the United States and our partners have just announced an interim agreement with Iran on the future of Iran's nuclear program. So today is So as the cherry blossoms are falling outside, it's a perfect day to be inside here, away from the rain, talking about nuclear non-proliferation and disarmament. I'd like to thank the city of Hiroshima and Jogakuin for hosting this event, and commend the James Marx Center for Non-Proliferation Studies at the Middlebury Institute of International Studies in Monterey for convening this event, and personally thank Masato Toki for this opportunity. Most importantly, I'd like to congratulate you, the students, for your participation. As a diplomat living in Japan, I've had the opportunity to attend many receptions here, but last night was the first time I've been serenaded with strangers in the night. So thank you for that very special memory. And seriously, I'm very encouraged to see you take an interest in this topic, which is more important now than ever before, as evidenced by the news of this morning. When it comes to nuclear weapons, there is no margin for error. We have to get it right. And to do that, we need the support of people from around the world to cooperate together. By participating in this conference, you have taken an important first step in what I hope will be a lifetime of working with people from different cultures and different backgrounds to make our world a better place for the sake of all humanity. You've already spoken a lot about the policies and challenges facing nuclear non-proliferation, and I'd like to take this time for us to think a little bit more about the role that individuals play in this effort. President Obama has said, "Peace with justice means pursuing the security of a world without nuclear weapons." The question is, how do we get to that peace? And my answer to you is through people. We need people just like you to overcome the cultural divides and the language barriers that separate us to work together on this important common goal. So in this time that I have with you, I'd like to talk about a few things. I'll give you a quick overview about my background. We'll talk a little bit about diplomacy. I'll introduce tree diplomacy. Talk a little bit about the Cuban Missile Crisis, the NPT, and the power of people-to-people relationships as in the context of the U.S.-Japan alliance. So, some quick background about me. I was born in Michigan. When I was a young child, I moved to Connecticut, where I grew up, and I had the opportunity to attend Choate Rosemary Hall, go Choate, beat Deerfield. I went from Connecticut to the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. And after that, I really wanted to get to know my country a little bit better. So I traveled across the country and moved to Los Angeles, lived there for a couple years where I worked as a newspaper reporter. Then I traveled back across the country, moved to Boston, and about 9 years ago, I joined the U.S. government State Department, which is like our foreign ministry. And they taught me Spanish, sent me to Mexico, where I worked for 2 years on the Yucatan Peninsula before coming back to Washington, where I took a real interest in Asian policy, and particularly U.S.-Japan relations. And I had the great fortune to have the opportunity to study some Japanese and move to Japan in 2012. And I've been working at the embassy in our public affairs section, trying to promote people-to-people relations between people of Japan and the United States since 2013. And one of the main efforts that we're trying to get engaged on is bringing young people like you together. So I'm really pleased to see all of you here. And I know that some of the students have already come to the United States, and I hope that the international students who are here, the non-Americans, will come to the United States in the future to maintain the relationships that you started today. So my job as a diplomat, it's good to review exactly what diplomacy is. So here's a dictionary definition of diplomacy: the art and practice of conducting negotiations between nations, skill in handling affairs without arousing hostility, tact. 英語で外交手腕. I can't pronounce it in Russian, sorry. But I think especially with this news about Iran today, I saw President Obama said that the result was because of months of tough, principled diplomacy. But are there other kinds of diplomacy than this dictionary definition we see here? Well, I'd like to tell you a story about tree diplomacy. So I know what you're thinking, what do trees have to do with nuclear weapons? But bear with me for a few minutes and we'll come full circle. So does anybody know where this picture of these cherry blossoms is? Washington, D.C., that's right. The woman in the bottom left-hand corner, her name was Eliza Skidmore. And in the late 1800s, Eliza came to Japan to visit her brother, who was the U.S. consul in Yokohama. And she saw the cherry trees like you've had the opportunity to see this week, and she was so impressed by their beauty that when she came back to Washington, she proposed that they plant cherry trees in Washington, D.C., and people thought her idea was a little crazy, so it didn't happen. But Eliza really believed in it. She was passionate about it, and for 25 years, she fought for this vision she had of bringing cherry trees to Washington, and she wrote a letter in 1910 or 1911 to Helen Taft, who was the wife of the president. And the first lady, Helen Taft, read the letter, and she thought it was a great idea. And when the Japanese consul in New York City found out about the idea, they decided to make it happen. And so Japan sent 2,000 cherry trees to Washington, D.C. to plant them. So those cherry trees arrived in Washington. They opened them up, they looked at them, and the cherry trees were infested with bugs. They couldn't be used, and they had to be destroyed. They were burned. So how come we have this, we never see this picture of the burning cherry trees, we see this picture of the flowering cherry trees along the Potomac River? Well, the gentleman in the top right-hand corner was Yukio Ozaki. He was the mayor of Tokyo. And when he found out the cherry trees had to be burned and destroyed, he decided to double down. And instead, he sent 3,000 cherry trees back to Washington to replace those that had been destroyed. And those trees arrived in Washington and were planted in 1912 along the banks of the Potomac River. And many of those trees are still standing today. So again, what does this have to do with today's topic? Well, 100 years ago, those trees were planted, and in 2012, to repay or to show our gratitude for that gift, the United States decided to send 3,000 dogwood trees to the people of Japan. And for the past few years, we've been planting those dogwood trees all around Japan. And when Ambassador Caroline Kennedy arrived in Japan in November of 2013, just a couple weeks after she had arrived in early December, she made one of her first trips outside of Tokyo to Nagasaki. And here she visited the Peace Park in Nagasaki, which of course is a place of great historical significance. And she planted dogwood trees as a symbol of the friendship between the people of Japan and the United States. And this was just a few days after Nelson Mandela had passed away. And I'd like to read you just a short bit of what she said in her remarks. In the days since Nelson Mandela has passed away, we have all been reminded of the power of reconciliation and the fact that we must continue to work for peace and justice, freedom of speech and worship. And your community has led the way in those efforts for more than half a century. My father was committed to eliminating nuclear weapons, and his proudest accomplishment as president was to pass the Limited Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. I am proud that President Obama shares President Kennedy's commitment to pass the new START treaty, which will greatly reduce the number of devastating weapons. But we must all continue to advocate for peace in this difficult and dangerous world. So there are a few lessons I would like you to come away from this tangent into tree diplomacy. And number one, and stick to your guns like Eliza Skidmore. Don't give up when you have an idea and the passion, the energy to pursue that idea. Make your dreams a reality. And don't ever underestimate your power as an individual. You can make a difference in this world. Don't forget that a seed of an idea you plant today literally can focus the world on an issue of great importance in the future. A tree is a tree, but it can also be a great symbol. And lastly, to shift gears, I would like to circle back to what an interesting time it is here to have Ambassador Kennedy, the daughter of President John F. Kennedy, here in Japan. This year, as you of course know, marks the 45th anniversary of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, which has its roots in the Limited Nuclear Test Ban Treaty, which has its roots in the Cuban Missile Crisis. I won't go into depth about the crisis, but I would like to recommend to you a book about the crisis called Essence of Decision by Graham Allison, a professor at Harvard's Kennedy School of Government. And Dr. Allison analyzes the crisis through a few different lenses. He looks at it, to paraphrase, from the view of a country, the organizations and bureaucracies within that country, and then, of course, the people that are making those decisions. We say frequently things like, the United States is committed to seeking the peace and security of a world without nuclear weapons. In international affairs, we often fall back on this language. We personify countries as if they are rational human actors. And here we see in the bottom left-hand corner a picture of a woman during the Cuban Missile Crisis holding up a sign saying, let the UN handle the crisis, not a person but an organization. And of course, within those organizations, there are competing offices and bureaucracies. And if you drill down even deeper, you find that behind the countries and the bureaucracies, there are people, real life people, just like you and me, who are making the decisions that affect all humanity. So here in this picture, those human beings are caricatured. We see President Kennedy and Khrushchev arm wrestling while sitting on top of nuclear weapons. But in real life, this is what they look like. We see that President Kennedy is not the imposing arm wrestler, but a real human being. He clearly looks concerned in this picture, which was taken in the middle of the crisis. And ultimately, major policies that affect the course of history come down to how well individuals can communicate. In this case, Kennedy and Khrushchev were able to communicate through back channels during the crisis, and that communication ultimately saved the world from nuclear war. So our lessons, again, do not underestimate the power of the individual. Even in your groups, you probably will feel at times those group dynamics tugging you and pulling you in certain directions. Make sure that you're moving in the right direction, the direction that you believe is right. Make sure you fight for what you believe in. And remember again the lesson of today that came from months of tough, principled diplomacy. We can say that the United States, Russia, partners reached an agreement with Iran, but we can also say that Secretary Kerry, Foreign Minister Lavrov, and Foreign Minister Zarif came to an agreement. There are real people making these decisions that affect us all. So I'd like to speak briefly about the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, which I know that you have been studying in detail, as another great example of what we can as nations and also as individuals accomplish by working together. 45 years ago, the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty came into force, and at the time that the treaty was signed, it was widely predicted that dozens of countries would develop nuclear weapons, a prospect that would threaten to disrupt global stability and security. Instead, thanks to worldwide collective efforts and commitments, the NPT has become the cornerstone of a nuclear non-proliferation regime that has reinforced international peace and security and prevented the further spread of nuclear weapons while promoting the peaceful use of nuclear energy. And today, global nuclear stockpiles are at their lowest levels since the 1950s. And the NPT remains essential today, and our efforts to achieve nuclear disarmament cannot succeed unless we stand together to prevent the spread of nuclear weapons and work for full compliance with the NPT. Earlier this year, we marked the fourth anniversary of the entry into force of the new START Treaty. And we we are successful in implementing the New START treaty with Russia in a way that will reduce strategic nuclear forces to their lowest levels in more than 50 years. And decades of effort have taught us that there is no alternative to practical, responsible, and verifiable step-by-step disarmament, and that the International Atomic Energy Agency is necessary to promote the safe, secure uses of nuclear energy and to ensure that it remains exclusively peaceful. The story of how the United States and Russia, once two adversaries, are cooperating on START reminds me of the relationship between the United States and Japan, and how that relationship has evolved over the last 70 years. So I'd like to take some time now to focus on this special relationship, because it's the foundation of so much work that the U.S. Embassy is focused on here in Japan. So this picture was taken in 1945, shortly after the war. This is Emperor Showa with General Douglas MacArthur, and they are standing in what is now the U.S. Ambassador's residence in Tokyo. This room still exists. We have many functions in it. It's a place where we bring together people to talk and to learn more about each other. But if you look at this picture here, you can see that it's an interesting dynamic. Here are these two leaders who have been thrown together by fate after this great war, and they're trying to adjust to a new path together. Let's flash forward. 15 years later, the United States and Japan are signing the Treaty of Mutual Cooperation and Security. This treaty is the framework of the U.S.-Japan military alliance. It's a very important document. And you can see now we are sitting down at a table, and the body language is a little bit warmer, but still guarded. So now we're going to jump forward about 50 years. We see President Obama with Prime Minister Abe, and they're shaking hands and smiling. So my question is this: how did we go from this to this to this? Well, we certainly had a lot to overcome. And let's start with some of the cultural differences. So for those of you who are not Japanese and you've been staying with host families this past week, I'm sure you've observed a lot of cultural differences. I'd love to hear about them, but I won't put you on the spot right now. But I just want you to think a little bit about them. Just here's a simple example. So in the West, we tend to greet people with a handshake. And in Japan, the courtesy is to bow. And just like with our handshake, we have different levels of it. People sometimes shake harder or weaker. With the ojigi, the bow, depending on how deep somebody bows, shows different levels of respect. But we can focus on differences. But in order for us to communicate across borders and solve the challenges that face our global community, I believe that we have to focus on similarities and find those common threads that tie us together. So let's look at some similarities. So maybe at first these look a little bit like differences, but I think that they're similarities. So let's start with food. So hamburgers, kind of a quintessential American food. But in Japan, hamburgers are incredibly popular. On my way coming here today, I passed a Mos Burger. And yesterday, I saw at a okonomiyaki restaurant, Hambaga Okonomiyaki. How about sushi? So washoku, now a UNESCO World Heritage. Also incredibly popular all around the world, especially in the United States. What about sports? Baseball started in the United States, our national pastime, but now incredibly popular in Japan. And soccer, the United States and Japan, our women's soccer teams are rivals. They're two of the world's best competing in the Olympics and the World Cup. But of course, our similarities run a lot deeper than just food and sports. So what do we see this woman doing in the top left-hand corner? Does anybody know what she's doing? She's voting. And our country countries believe in democratic principles and the right to elect through voting our leaders who will represent us. And those who are not Japanese in the room, do you know what the bottom left is? It's a koban. Does everybody know what a koban is? You've probably seen them or walked by them the past few days. A koban is, loose translation, is a police box. And they're on many corners all over Japan. And if you have a problem, you can stop in. There's always a police officer on duty who can answer your question. And I put that in here to show that our countries believe in the rule of law and how important it is to have that respect for the rule of law, because it keeps our societies working in order and place. And of course, on the right side, you see a police officer talking to children. And I put this in there to connect the rule of law with something that's even more important, and that's our children. Because whatever society, whatever country, whatever people you're talking about, the thing that we care about more than anything is our children. And I believe, or I'd like to believe, that that's part of the reason why the students, why you're here today. Because not only do you care about the world that you're going to inherit as you become adults, but you also care about the world that you're going to leave behind to the people who follow in your footsteps. I think it's essential to keep those young children, that next generation, in mind as we put together public policy in international affairs. Here in Japan, let's see how we're doing over time. I'd like to just give you a couple of examples of some programs that we've done to try to bring the young people of the United States and Japan together and turn a tragedy into a positive. So I think many of you will remember the March 11th, 2011 earthquake, tsunami, and nuclear disaster that affected the Tohoku region of Japan and killed thousands of people and left thousands more homeless. The United States has a number of military assets here in Japan, and following that, in the immediate aftermath of that earthquake, those assets were mobilized, and U.S. soldiers cooperated with soldiers from the Japanese Self-Defense Force to go to that affected region to try to help the people get the supplies that they need, clear the airport and roads so that other aid could get to those people. And that military operation was called Operation Tomodachi. Tomodachi means friend in Japanese. And in the aftermath of that operation, the U.S. Embassy launched a new initiative called the Tomodachi Initiative, which was designed to try to create a new generation of U.S. Japanese students who would help foster our alliance for years to come. And so you can see some of the Tomodachi students who have come to the United States. And this is just one example, just one picture of one program. Literally hundreds of Japanese students and American students have gone gone to each other's country through the Tomodachi Initiative. And we've done many other programs, tree plantings, bringing our U.S. soldiers out into the community, and bringing figures from the United States to try to connect with Japanese youth. This is a player from the U.S. women's soccer team doing a youth camp in Tohoku. Also, in the news, when foreign leaders visit each other, you often see those pictures on news of the leaders meeting in places like the White House or the Conte, having those high-level political meetings. But when President Obama and senior leaders from the U.S. government travel overseas, they always try to connect with young people because they know how important you are to the future. And President Obama visited Japan about a year ago, April 2014. And I'd like to just show you a quick video. It's about 2 minutes, just to show you a little bit more about what that visit was about. Because many of you, especially Japanese, may have seen pictures of President Obama just with Prime Minister Abe, but I want to show you that the visit was a little bit more than that.
Thank you. It is wonderful to be back in Japan. This is my third visit as president. I'm deeply honored to be making the first state visit by a U.S. president in nearly two decades. I'm grateful to their majesties, the emperor and empress, for their gracious welcome this morning. And I've once again been touched by the kindness and hospitality of the Japanese people. I'm pleased that we continue to deepen the extraordinary ties between our people, especially our young people, like the Japanese students that I'll be meeting later today.
So I hope you heard in that video the president talk about people and students. That's really what I wanted you to come away from, because, again, it's more than just about the leaders. It's about the next generation. It's about all of you and how you're going to play a role in the future of our world. As I said at the beginning, today is a really important first step for many of you, and I hope that many of you will continue to pursue study abroad opportunities, whether those are Americans going to Japan, Russia is continuing to come to Japan or visiting the United States, or Japanese going to Russia and the United States. Because while these forums are a great opportunity to get people together, it's just a start to a conversation. And through study abroad, you can enhance your communication skills and learn more about the cultures. And we need people like that, people like Sako, for example, who understand two cultures, two languages, and can help bridge together two people. The more people we have like that in international affairs, the better. I think it is worth noting that Foreign Minister Zarif, for example, studied in the United States. And so certainly in international negotiations, having that cross-cultural fluency can really make a great difference. And so in the future, when you become adults and policymakers, and you come into a negotiating room, and you're sitting down to discuss an important issue, maybe like nuclear non-proliferation, you can look across the table, and perhaps you'll find and see a friend that you made while you were in Hiroshima many years ago at the Critical Issues Forum. And that friendship can help be the difference maker in helping your two sides find a common agreement. Well, maybe you'll be that lucky and find a friend sitting across the table from you. Maybe you'll just find somebody who has been a link between your two cultures. Maybe you can be that bridge. I'm so pleased to see you all working together on this important issue. Oh, and here I'd just like to put up some resources, especially for Japanese students in the audience. There's some more links for you to check out about studying in the United States and about the Tomodachi Initiative. I'm sorry, I don't have links here for the Russian students, but I understand that some of your teachers are in touch with my colleagues at the consulate in Yekaterinburg, and Masako has my email, and I encourage you to get in touch with me, and I can put you in touch with people in Russia who can give you some more examples and more resources if you are interested in studying in the United States. I will be sticking around during the break, so for the students, please feel free to come up and talk to me, and I'd be happy to give you some more information. So again, I'm really excited to see you all here working today and discussing this important issue. I sincerely hope that the friendships you make through this opportunity last far beyond your trip to Hiroshima and lead to a lasting cooperation between the people of the United States, Japan, and Russia. Domo arigatou gozaimashita. Spasiba. Thank you very much.